for today. And actually, we gonna have some important thing to discuss first. Most of you may be really curious about how should or how important this subject gonna involve with you. And since recognize that is important to you, let me start by thinking about when you finish as a graduate in civil engineering. Actually, you guys is not considered as a civil engineer yet. In the US, you got to have what's so called engineering in training program. That's gonna take you about 2 years to practice before you have a chance to test the what's so called the examination to get the license. In Thailand also, but in Thailand is a little bit more easy. You don't need to have 2 years practice. You can finish from the undergraduate degree and you can take examination and get the license. Achan, if I'm Cambodia, I can do so. Yes, our curriculum approved by what's so called the Council of Engineer of Thailand, or in Thai we call it GOWO. Okay, it's have engineering license. Based on that, you got to take the examination. And as I said, the examination from the COE will be separate into two parts. One is the basic courses. There are four basic courses, including the statics, engineering statics, the graphic, engineering graphics, okay, and engineering material. Let me write it engineering over here, and engineering material. And the final is computer programming. That is four subjects, okay? And these four subjects gonna be 100 points. Anyway, you must have 60 plus points to pass it. And again, the second part of the COE examination, you're gonna take the professional courses, professional, C-O-U-R-S-E-S courses. The professional courses also divide into four groups, okay? The first one, the theory of structure and the structural analysis. The second one is the reinforced concrete design and the steel design. And the third is going to be the soil mechanics. It not include the foundation, just soil mechanics. And the last one is the option, okay? It's the option. You may select it for construction management. Construction management. Or you may select for the water resources engineering, or you may select the water resources engineering. That's going to include the hydraulic and hydraulic engineering. And then again, that is going to be 100 points, and you require 60 points to pass it. Okay, it's separate into two parts. And then when you graduate, no, sorry, when you pass the examination, you got to attend the, what's so called, ethic seminar, something like that, right? You got to have some oplom to finish it. That's all thing. What happened is, how about this course? This course not actually directly related to the COE license, but when you decide the structure, you're gonna require the analysis, okay? And in the process before the analysis, you require what? You require the planning. But the process between planning into the analysis and design, you got to do the modeling. Remember last lecture that we have in the theory of structure, you got to model the architectural plan and architectural model into structural model in order you to transfer the force to the slab, transfer the force from the slab to the beam, from the beam to the column, and do again until getting to the footing. Okay. Anyway, by the modeling, we talking about it in what? In the theory of structure, right? But anyway, during the process, you got to do what? You got to select material, which material you are going to use to build your structure. Okay. And related to the modeling in the theory of structure, we talking about the design code. We talking about the building code, CODES. Okay. See, the material, when you select the design code, building code going to be the design code for the reinforced concrete, the design code for pre-stressed concrete, the design code for the steel, the design code for the timber. This is the starting point. And how to select the material? That's a lot governed by the owner. Let's say we're talking about being a house, and then the owner have 10 million baht to build a house. You're going to have a lot of choices, okay? 10 million baht, you can build a good timber house. You also can build a reinforced concrete house. And if you prefer really large span and beautiful no beam structure, you can use the pre-stressed concrete. Okay, this is the option of the owner. And the architect going to tell the owner what the constraint, what that kind of thing before you select the correct choice. And then based upon this, let me talking about some example first. Let me come to what we have here. Can anyone turn off this light? That's going to help you. This is a seven-story building. Okay. And this again, coming to the 3D models again. And again, go back to the theory of structure. You're going to transform it into the structural plan. However, before you can do anything, you're going to select what the material you are going to use in this structure. Seven-story building, not much. You may go by the reinforced concrete for the footing, for the columns, okay? However, for the slab and the beam, there are choices. You may prefer to use the pre-stressed concrete. Okay, if you use the pre-stressed concrete, you didn't study over here. Most of the time, pre-stressed concrete require the advanced courses in master degree. And anyway, we have the pre-stressed courses teach you for the beam, teach you for the maybe the column. That's kind of a lot already. But anyway, Ajahn Mongkhorn may mention some by using the computer program to do the pre-stressed concrete later. But anyway, coming into this, you just go to the calculation sheet for this one. I did put this file into the Facebook, download it. Download it, and you will see the detail of this. If not, it's not really clear on it. What it said, the first very step, you got to do the design criteria. After you select what the material you are going to use, first, what the design standard going to involve, okay? It's going to be the building regulation from the Ministry of Interior and the Bangkok Metropolitan Administration. This is the legal thing. This first step is the legal thing. These two items are registration from the government. Okay, it's the minimum you must follow. And then if you go further, what the EIT? EIT is Engineering Institute of Thailand under the King Phanonich. Okay, recommendation on RC design. That means they select the RC design. And then you also need to use the ACI. Why? You have the building code already. Why you got to use the design code? What I said in the theory of structure, because some of you guys didn't attend that. Because what? The building code may be old, really old, okay? Because it's really hard to change the building code. But the design code can change by the profession, especially the research from the academic and the experience from the profession. They merge together over there and develop the design code for that. So that means this is more advanced and it is more current than the building code. And see, this was in the steel construction. So that means this structure also has the steel. So you got to follow what it is, the steel design. That is follow the EIT. And for the international one, they use the American Institute of Steel Construction as the recommendation for you design. As an international student, I recommend you to search Google for the ACI, to search the Google for the ASC, to get more used to with those international organization. Okay, and then go a little bit further. That is going to be RC and PC construction. That is for the construction of reinforced concrete and the prestressed concrete. You're going to use what? It's strength design method. Okay, there are two themes of design, actually three. One is what called the working stress design or working strength. Another one called the strength design. Actually, it's also called the ultimate design. And it also has in the term of European, limit state design. What's so called? We have working strength design. We also have ultimate strength design. That is from the US size. For the European, you will have limit state. Limit state is very similar to the ultimate in the concept of design. You're gonna provide the load factor and you're going to provide the strength reduction factor. So strength reduction factor to reduce the strength of the material. And the load factor used to increase the estimated load that you do in the theory of structure. And then if you go further, it's going to have the third section. This third section gonna involve with us on the material testing. It's going to provide the concrete. Concrete have type A, concrete have type B. It said ultimate strength of the concrete type A is this. Ultimate strength of concrete type B is 320. This is for the normal reinforced concrete. Okay, it's a typical concrete for the steel. And the second one, this is the concrete for prestressed concrete. Okay, that is more advanced. And then they provide you modulus of elasticity and modulus of elasticity. That means you guys must know both compressive stress and modulus of elasticity. And then this one will be based upon the company, those SCG or TPI, which company you may select. and then the cement used in the production of this concrete must follow the TIS. Follow what? Follow by the TIS and follow the mixed design of the concrete. And this mixed design you will study from the course of concrete technology by Ajahn Thirawat. Okay, that is another course talking purely about the concrete, because concrete is important and concrete is quite complex material. It contains both cement, water, sand, gravel, and additive. There are different kinds of additive, such as water retardant. Remember water retardant? That's going to reduce the water need to add to the cement. Okay. And this is water reducing agent. The one that hold the concrete to react slower. What's so called? The additive. น้ำยาเพิ่มมันหน่วงอ่ะมันหน่วงการก่อปฏิกิริยา What's so called? But it's okay. There are a lot of additive for sure. And this is another course you going to study again about the TIS. Okay. And then what else do we have from this? You're going to expect the rebar. What the rebar? Rebar is going to be the steel. Okay, there is type A rebar, there is type A rebar, different type A. This one for the rod. Okay, this one for the round bar. And this one is for the deformed bar. You know the round bar? Round bar usually used for the shear reinforcement. This one for the shear reinforcement. This one for the main reinforcement. You may ask people more about this if you like. Okay. And also have the Y mesh. What's your Y mesh for? What's the Y mesh for? Temperature steel. They're going to be on the top to prevent the crack due to the temperature of the concrete, because the concrete surface may subject to the sunlight during the daytime. That's going to be very hot. If you do believe it, take your shoe off, walk on the concrete slab. That's this time, this afternoon. Okay. And then what we have is what? What we have, the pre-stressed reinforcement. Again, this requires steel. And you may see all of this going to ask you for the strength, yield strength, modulus of elasticity. Again, this is come to the TIS. TIS for what? TIS for the RB. TIS for what? TIS for the DB. TIS for what? For the Y mesh. Okay. TIS for what? TIS for the, this one. This one called the PC strength. There are a lot of things that you're going to involve with. Okay. And then if you go further, that is the steel in the shape of the steel rod or steel cable. Now, for the steel structure, it's going to have the structural steel. For the structural steel, the grade gonna indicated here. And then the yield strength come, modulus of elasticity come. See, this is a lot of material, right? Until now, quite a lot. It's okay, right? And you are going to involve with this one. So coming back, as a civil engineer, over here, you are working like a design engineer. When you are the design engineer, you're going to be the one who set the criteria. I am the design, okay? Owner, like this. When you decide it, you start to set up everything like this. before you go further. Further what? Go further for even the mixed design. If you like to have 320 kilogram per square centimeter, you may ask what the TPI going to give you the price. You may ask for SCG, what's going to be the price for that? And usually, all of come from the SCG or come from the TPI is go past the ACI. So if 1 cubic meter costs 2,400 baht and another one costs 2,500 baht, which one you going to buy? Usually it's the cheaper one because they are going to pass the minimum requirement. Okay, but some people said, I believe in SCG. Even though it's more expensive, I'm going to buy it. So depend on the owner, okay? But for ourselves, if we are the construction company, we are going to buy the cheaper one, okay? And then coming into this, again, you got to do the second thing, the plan of the structure and the modeling. We're talking about this a lot yesterday, right? So today, just get what you have, the PDF file, and go back, try to study about it. Again, this is going to be a 7-story building. So from the footing plan, first plan, second plan, and you may see the first and second plan very similar to each other, right? If you go first three, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, and the eighth, most of the time, the higher four just repeated itself, okay? Most of the higher building, high-rise building, okay, have some same, have some floor plan. So that is going to be easier for us to design, and it's also convenient to contact her to build it. Okay. Any question on this? At the end, I like to conclude that why I show this to you. I like you guys to have a touch, okay? Especially the example that I gave to you. What will be your duty in the coming future? You are the one who going to negotiate with architect and negotiate with the owner, select the material. When you are the designer, you are the one who provide all the criteria. Again, that is not only the designer. Some like to work as the site engineer, which is the engineer that's work for constructing the structure. What is your duty? You are the owner, right? You're gonna build the structure based upon the contract that you sign with the owner. And you're going to buy the concrete. You're going to buy the steel from the supplier, right? What kind of concrete would you like to have? The one that's passed the criteria. What is the criteria? The designer said on the very first pages. The steel also, the piece state wide also. How do you check it? How to check it? First, you got to know the TAS. What the property of the material supposed to be, such as the modulus of elasticity of the steel, the yielding stress of the steel. Okay, actually it's supposed to be the ultimate stress and percent elongation also. And since you know it, okay, based on your contact, how do you correct the sample? The TS will give you like every 50,000 kilometer of the steel, you got to sample 2 meter of steel, 3 pieces. Every 30 cubic meter of the concrete, that is quite a lot, that's 6 tuck. You're going to take 5 sample out of that. gases in the cylinder. And then what else do you know, need to know it? You got to know how to test it if possible. If your company is so big like Italian Thai, you may have your institute for testing. Okay, but for the small company, you may send to SUT if you work around here. If you work in Bangkok, you may send to any university that have this testing service. Okay, to what? To confirm what we get when we pay the money. Okay, that is the thing. So you also, you need to know the TS. You need to know how to perform the test. And you need to know to read the report. They're going to provide you the report. What you are going to do, that is the report. Okay, you get to take the value from the report. Everything about. So whichever you are working on, you must know what I'm talking about. Okay, in this material testing course. And then what happened in the structure with the improper construction or improper design? That is the very big, bad thing that we don't like to have in our province. That is in 1993. I don't think anyone of you born on the 1993, okay? And at the time we set up SUT, that is this failure occur in Kolat. It's failure because the building just get the expansion from 3-4 building into the 6-4 building. And there are something about factor of safety, right? Factor of safety usually about 2. And if you build from the 3-4 into the 6-4, that's you use all the factor of safety. And then a meeting come, a lot of people attend a meeting, and by doing that, the column cannot support the road from the activities, and the structure just collapse. Another thing, not even in Thailand, in America also, many years ago in the Civic Center. Civic Center like somewhere the people come have activity together, like election. Okay, they do the election at the Civic Center. This Civic Center have the rooftop, and then snow come. Snow different from water. From the water, get to the roof, run down. Snow may or may not, okay? It may accumulate onto the roof. And then what happened? This is snow, but that's occurred many years ago, very far away, okay? But in the year 2000, there are another accident in the US. It's the pedestrian bridge cross the road. Okay, I should mention the first two examples is based is on the first one, do some mistakes of the design. Okay, the second one didn't expect the snow load. Okay, this third one is destroyed by the corrosion. What's so called over here is if you build a structure, the structure like a car, you got to put the car to the service, right? Kanchana, right? You have a car, you got to put it into service like a year for oil change. That is too much. Yeah, if you die a lot, maybe just half years. That's a lot already. The same thing, when you have the structure, you got to take care, especially the steel. Why? The steel can interact with water and oxygen, and then it's called the rust, right? When the steel rusty, what so-called is part of steel will corrode, and then the section of steel will get smaller. So you got to take care of that to prevent this kind of thing. Okay, and now in the TS, what TAS gonna indicate? The first one, the TAS will indicate the texture or the physical property of the material. So when you buy like 30 ton of steel, each kilo of steel can cost you like 20 baht per kilogram. And if you buy it for 30 ton, you're going to pay for what? You're going to pay for 30,000 times 20. That's going to cost you 600,000 AWS car. Okay. In the site, it's very easy to say, to buy a 30 ton steel. And then you're going to check if the steel have rust on it, those kind of things. And if you go more, not the shape and size, you can go to the density. You may measure the length, a given length, and find the area. And then you get the volume. You just put the steel on a scale and you divide it by the volume. You get the density, right? Remember last lecture on the theory? What the density of the steel? If you get the density of 60 kilonewton per cubic meter, is that all right to you? What is supposed to be for the density of steel? Last lecture, I did talk about this. This is about 78 kilonewton or 7,800 kilogram per cubic meter. What the density of the concrete? I'm going to relate this concept together. Okay? Use your knowledge if you have. What the density of the concrete? Man, if you go to the outside, you don't know about the density of the concrete, I won't hire you as an engineer. Or if I hire you, I will fire you back for my construction site. You don't have any knowledge. I don't want to pay you the money. Some basic thing you got to know. How about the concrete? 24. It's going to be like 2,400 kilogram per cubic meter. Okay, and put another zero into it. That is going to be 24 kilonewton per cubic meter. Some people really exact. Ajahn, it's 23.6. Yes, it's 23.6. It's okay. It's 23.6. Okay, you don't get to know that. Why? Why you should know that? You're going to use this to estimate the dead load of your structure, right? Right? You're going to estimate the load by using the sensitivity. And then you got to very, very understanding about the strength. When we check the strength of the concrete, what would you like to check? Strength of the concrete. Is called F palm sub C for the concrete. It's going to be ultimate compressive stress of the concrete. The concrete is in compression. The strength of the concrete in compression. Why? Okay, you don't tell me. When you check the strength of this steel, you may check it by what's our symbol? It's different, right? If you go to the steel design, they use it F sub Y. I don't know why, okay? If you come from mechanics of material, we use it sigma sub Y. You need stress. It's intention, right? Why? Strength, the same word. But for the concrete, from the compression. For the steel, from the tension. Because the concrete has the higher strength, 10 times larger than the tensile strength, the first one. The second one, that's why we use the concrete in the column to taking care of the compression. Ajahn, how about the beam? Yes, you use the concrete in the beam, but you use the top portion of the beam, of the concrete, to calculate the strength. How about the bottom? You put the reinforcement. The reinforcement at the bottom going to be in tension. Okay. That means still is in tension mostly. So what we are setting here basis of on what we use is and is going to related based upon we are going to work in the future. And come to the stiffness. What is stiffness? This is for the strength. We use the yielding stress for the steel. We use the ultimate compressive stress for the concrete. How about the stiffness? The stiffness we use what's so called the modulus of elasticity. For the steel, it's going to be E sub S. For the concrete, it's going to be E sub C. Which one going to be larger? Which one? E sub. In Thai, มั่นใจหน่อย confidence yourself. E sub S. Okay. E sub S gonna have like 200 gigapascal. E of the concrete depend on the strength of the concrete. Typically, it's going to be about 20 to 30 gigapascal. Okay, that is about 9 times less than the steel. And then there are some work that need to be considered. For example, the chemical property. Okay, some people may use the stainless steel if the steel going to build near the seashore. Near Chai Fung. Why? Because as a seashore, there is the sea, right? The water vapor will come to your structure and also the salt going to attack your structure with the oxygen, with those kind of thing. Your structure will corrode, the steel structure going to corrode very easily. How about stainless steel? Stainless steel is a kind of steel that costs 3 times more expensive than typical steel. It won't last. It can tolerate to the seawater. There are some special steel that build a large boat, okay? That build a warship, those kind of thing. So you got to do that also, but not for our construction material, right? But anyway. You still need to, even though it's not quite. For example, if you are going to build reinforced concrete structure at SUT, and you are going to build the concrete structure in the sea, what should be different between them? P will know that. Because P have the RC design already. It's related to the use of the structure and the construction. Thinking about if you build it over here, the code said, you just have the covering of the steel, of the concrete of 25 millimeter. What's so called? This is going to be the main reinforcement. This is going to be the stirrup. Okay. What I'm saying about the covering of the concrete, that is going to be this thing. This is the cover of the concrete over the steel to protect the steel. Okay. If you're going to build this thing in the seawater, you're going to make it bigger. People remember how big it's going to be? It's going to be 3 times thicker from 25 millimeter minimum into 75 millimeter minimum. I did one because actually I from Lanong. Okay, my hometown in Phetchaburi. I did some design for the steel reinforced concrete structure and the steel structure in the seawater. So you got to consider material closely. You got to consider the detail of the construction very closely. Okay? And then when you construct it, you're going to hire the contractor that's used to with that kind of special thing. Okay? Okay, next, we come to different kind of material, but let me say the first and the second are very important. Actually, the fourth also important, but not important for Thai people, like water suction. In the cold country, okay, thinking about you have the reinforced concrete or the masonry structure, and then during the winter, there not only snow, there also rain, like in Texas. Texas is not that cold, but in the daytime, in the winter, the temperature may be 10 degrees Celsius. And then there come the rain during the afternoon. Okay, the structure get wet. The concrete absorb some water into it. The masonry also. But when get at night, okay, after the midnight, the temperature may get down to -5. What happened is the water frozen. What happened when the water frozen? This is a thesis of my friend when study over there. When the ice frozen, what happened? It expand. Okay. If there is a lot of pore size in the material, there is going to be a lot of water and it's going to be a lot of forces from the expansion of the ice. And some surface of the concrete, okay, may just take out due to the icing of the water. That's called the importance of the water suction. Okay, but in Thailand, do we have that? No, in Cambodia also. Do you have? We have. Many years ago, I worked with Ajahn Sat Sukhprasad. Okay, there is our senior graduate from Khon Kaen University has the frozen storage in Sung Nen. And then he has the problem. He called us, Ajahn, what happened to my frozen room? What happened is what I told you. The concrete just spall off due to the low quality concrete in the frozen room of that frozen storage. Okay, we may correct that by putting some special polymer agent to cover it. Now the room will have some special polymer to cover it. Polymer can prevent the reinforce from the water. But what happened is the storage room must close for some days, not in operation. Everything inside it got to take out. That's going to require some planning to fix it. Okay, we just fix it by taking a low quality concrete off and then put a new one with very dense concrete and put the polymer on the top to prevent. Okay, that is many things we can work on that. And then coming to strength, like I said, strength based on the structure. In the steel, we use tension, yielding stress from tension. In the concrete, we use ultimate compressive stress in compression because we use them differently, okay? We use them differently. That's why we test them differently. Okay, and then talking about the stiffness. Stiffness is measured by modulus of elasticity. And when you measure the stiffness, we just measure the slope. See, the slope of aluminum and slope of the wood, which one going to get larger slope? Which one? This one has higher or lower slope? This one low, right? So the aluminum has the higher modulus of elasticity than the wood or timber. Okay? And then when we talking about the strength, we talking about the yielding. Okay? The yielding. This yielding of the low carbon steel. And for the aluminum, what method we are going to use to estimate the yielding of the aluminum? For the steel, you know exactly, right? For the steel have a clear yielding point. You can estimate it clearly. And if you have the material, didn't have the clear yielding point, what method do you use? 0.2% offset, yeah? And then you just put something, this is 0.001, okay? This is 0.0005, this is about 0.0002, right? You just drag the line across this one in parallel with this portion, cut here, and you get this one as the sigma sub y of aluminum. And when you compare with the sigma sub y of steel, you can see sigma sub y of steel is a little bit higher. Okay, now you know the strength and stiffness. Those are very important property. Why? From the example, you may see from the design of the 7-story reinforced concrete building, most of the material just say two things, the strength and the modulus of elasticity, which is the stiffness. But actually, we still have some other thing. For example, we're going to have the percent elongation for the steel. We like steel to be really ductile material. Okay, and we also consider the ultimate stress of the steel and aluminum. Then go further. For the what? For the elasticity. Elasticity is the behavior of material in which when you pull it, and then when you release the, when you pull it, it's elongated, it's deformed. And when you release the force, it's just go back to original length. That is the elasticity. And how about the plasticity? When you elongate and you release the force, it's going to come some of the elongation. But it will have what's so called a permanent set or permanent elongation, right? And the energy capacity didn't use much here. That is the first part of that. I'm talking about what? And I'm talking about as being the engineer, the design engineer, the size engineer, you're going to get used to with those mechanical properties of material. The most important are stress, strength, and the stiffness. And from that, we're talking about the TAS, the Thailand Industrial Standard, which will specify the number of the mechanical property. And it's also tell us how do we test it. Now, coming to the material testing. There are three types of material testing. One going to involve with you, the testing for quality control, let's say. Testing for control, there is two control. Let's see. When I'm graduate, I work with the SCG in the concrete, what's so called, ready mixes concrete plant. Okay. Over there, I control the machine and the people to mix the aggregate, coarse stone, fine sand, water, and cement together by the mix design. And then before I put everything into the truck and send to Pipum company, I supposed to correct some of my sample, okay, to check the operation I'm doing. Now, when my truck go to the Pipum, Pipum also gonna correct some of my example to confirm with the owner of the building that the material he used in the construction is okay. Okay, that is two different things. One is me, I'm going to be the one who do this kind of test, quality control testing, and work with the manufacturer. Okay, I check what I produce before sending to my customer. Okay, get it, right? Okay, next, the customer will do the acceptance test. People who correct the example and do the test, which is going to be pass what said in the contract or not. If not, people will point up to my company. That is my mistake. What happened there, we're going to strengthen in the structure, will be caused to my company. This is something legal. And actually, our work is not just technical. All our work involved with money, man, and management. Actually, machine also, Sila said. Okay, as an engineer, we are talking about the working operation, not only technical knowledge we have. We're talking about man, money also, money management, okay? And worker management, that is man. And machine management, and material management also. That's a lot of things. It's not just thinking so narrow. Open your mind, there is still a lot of things. Even though you get the F, you just come back, recreate it. And if whenever you graduate, you may be better than the one who get the owner degree. Believe me, a lot of my friends like that. Okay. A good grade, graduate, being the professor. A lower grade, graduate, are being the owner of the big company. It's always like that. Then coming into the graduate study. This is for the engineer, right? Testing for control. There is two types of control, acceptance testing and quality control. Now you are going to graduate school. You have something that like to be developed. For example, new application, such as Ajahn Thilawat is working for the Ganchong mixed with HEMP, with the concrete. Ganchong fiber have really high strength. He showed me the strength of hemp fiber is as strong as the fiberglass fiber strength. Unbelievable. I also believe this. We got to say about 20 years. Fiberglass can do 20 years, but I don't know hemp going to be 20 years endurance. My opinion. What he said, Ajahn Srichai, you got the point. So, yes. Oh, actually, they have some speed test in the STM. And if not, you just cast the sample and wait for 10 years and do so. But there is an accelerated test that you got to put the water, put a lot of environment into it. There are special tests on that and require special machine. Anyway, if you like to go to the master degree, PhD also, you may interested in the testing for research and development. That's going to require a more accurate testing machine. And the last one, there is a project here. For example, they use the synchrotron light source over there to study the concrete structure, what's so called the geopolymer. That's mostly start by the scientists and work with the engineer how to modify the concrete as a high performance material. ซึ่งโคตรเก่ง high performance material something like that. Okay, and anyway, they are just different from the method of testing instrument accuracy, precision of the machine and the ability of the lab personnel. Mostly the last one, you are as the PhD candidate, you got to do it by yourself usually. But for the first one, most of the time engineer didn't do so. There is the lab boy over there in the lab helping you on that. That is for the second part. What I'm showing you here is my project. 23 years ago, when I come over here, I proposed university to build this kind of structural engineering lab. But I did get some. I get this, the UTM. I also get this, the loading frame. But still, I like to have this. Ajahn Mongkhon also is a checking table. It can check like a earthquake. Okay, but that's very expensive. Only the AIT and Chulalongkorn University has this. We have that enough for testing a lot of things, especially for some our local problem, our Isan problem. And then the third part, AS team, TIS, JIS, BS. All of these have the S, right? The S come from the standard, okay? The JS, the Japanese Industrial Standard. TS, Thai Industrial Standard. And then how, why? Why do we have the standard? We have the standard for some objective, one to protect consumer, okay? We got to protect the consumer from some dangerous thing. From hazardous that may occur by the material. The standard to set that. But the dangerous, it may contain some bad chemical in the cement, something like that. Like it may have the cadmium, those kind of things, and it may leak out. It may have some mercury also during the process. So that's set for prevent the consumer from the hazards. And it's said to prevent from unnecessary loss of economy. Some people just produce the cheap steel. For example, some steel over here, 20 baht per kilogram, but some steel from some country may come to Thailand with the cost of 15 baht. Have you ever shopped by Shopee, Lazada? That is the same thing from some country. That's quote cheap, very cheap, quote cheap. Something like that. That is for the standard to set for, especially something that's also important for our life. Okay, such as low quality steel, low quality cement, and then it's going to cause the collapse of the structure. Low quality is mean the strength of the concrete when you build it is the same as the normal. However, 20 years later, the strength of the material just reduced by itself by half. That can be occur. So we set the standard to prevent this kind of thing. And it's a guideline for manufacturer such as if you buy the light tube, see, light tube, if you buy for some specific length, it will install into this from any band, Philips, those kind of JTS, those kind of anything, for some thing. that put together. And then when we have in Thailand, we going to specify it to be TIS and specific number of it. The year, very old one, the year of it and the name of it. Okay, that is four components. This is TIS and number, the year and the name of it. Most of the time the TIS come from the well-known standard in the world. I like you guys to remember what the ASTM for, what the JS for, what the BS for, okay? The standard in our country, not just Thailand, Malaysia, Thailand, even though your country, don't worry. If you don't have much, you go back to your country, you can develop your own standard. And I don't like to put this. You know what? Putting the standards is a kind of putting the barrier for the trading. American use it. Do you notice why Americans still use inch and foot? Nearly all the world use the SI. That is a kind of making the trade barrier to the people. In Thailand also, our engineer use kilogram and centimeter. I think it is only one in the world who use this unit. That is a kind of trade barrier. Oh, okay, let's see if you are the Cambodian people, you like to work in Thailand, you got to adjust your brain, right? To make it. And I heard from Bunham, in Cambodia is a lot bad, a lot worse than this. It have many kind of units, Ajahn. Thai come to Cambodia, use Thai unit. Korean come, use Korean style unit. Chinese come. So over there, very tough. Thailand is tough, but over there is tougher because it can be come from many, many directions. Okay, just adjust yourself for that. Anyway, the TAS tell you two things. The TAS tell you two things. One is tell you specification for the steel, for example, for the steel by the TAS 1227. In the year 2539 for structure slow steel section. If you said you buy the steel for SM 400, you got to test it. It's going to pass the yielding, going to pass the ultimate, going to pass the percent elongation. And what I'm saying, pass it. It means pass at the same time. Not just only pass this. No, they're going to pass all factors. Okay? Not just one of them, just all factors. If you come to this, you use the yielding of this, you have the ultimate of this, and you get the percent elongation, this is a higher strength steel. And you may notice from this, the percent elongation just gets smaller, higher steel, higher strength steel, more brittle, okay? Because you put more thing into more alloy into it. The second thing is always examination. Oh, the examination is multiple choice, okay? A, B, C, D, E, don't worry, A, B, C, E, that helps you a lot. The second thing is tell you how to test it. Why? Because it's going to set to everyone for a type of steel to test with the same method. You cannot have your own method of testing. You got to follow this. Only this way to follow this. And this is the example for the concrete and for the steel, okay? Then there is two TAS symbol. There is two TAS symbol. One is the symbol with the circle around it. This is a must. This is legal thing. When it said this steel reinforcement rebar going to be follow this, that is a law. What it means is, Ajahn, my country also has the steel. Can I ship it to sell in Thailand? Yes, but you got to pass this. Okay. If your country don't have this, I can ship any steel from any country, from the country with Brazil or China to sell to you, right? Everyone can compete. If there is no standard, price going to be governed. That is very dangerous. At least go back home and set up the war for the people to jump across it. Okay, and that war going to be a reasonable war with the technique and with the construction method, that kind of thing. Don't set it too high. And then there is the one that not really a must, but recommended, especially for example, the pie, the precast pie. And actually now it's a precast wall, those kind of thing. Thing going to be like this. If this is a precast pie, if it have this kind of symbol, it's guarantee something that manufacturer follow the Ministry of Industry. Okay. If there is no symbol of all, it can be anything. And you got to compare the price. Okay. Last week we talking about buying a pie, diving for our graduate working in Udon Thani. Okay. One is going to be cost you 2,000 baht a pie. Another company going to sell for 1,800 baht a pie. Which one you going to buy? The 2,000 had a symbol. You got to weigh it. How many in your pocket going to be? Or how do you know the company produce 1,800 baht pie? They may not like to have the symbol, but the quality control of the company is so good, and we are friends. Something like that. We are friends. Anyway, sometimes friends are important. Better than that, yes. If you are the land developer, you are going to build a lot of house, okay? And the house gonna use the pie. Why don't you just set up your own company to do the precast for the pie? Okay? And if you do so, do you need to really follow this? Go to the Ministry of Industry, apply for those kind of symbol. No, sometimes you can do for just your own, and you have your own standard, right? To keep that thing more simple, you may have one that have no symbol of this in your product. People in Thailand is like this. And my uncle also do something like that. Okay. That is the end of first part of this. If you prefer, we have 5 minutes break. Okay. And come back at the 15. We still have a lot of things to discuss. It's maybe go to like a number 11. If we don't break, it's maybe go to about 10. But I think just take a break, 5 minutes, and come back. Okay, student, just come to the second part. On the chapter 2, analysis of data is very easy. I think all of you know about how to find the mean. For example, if you have the number of 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 which is going to be the mean 3 the mean you can find it okay this is some of the things sometimes we got to find the mean what's mean by the mean what means by the mean it's going to be something that divide the data into half if your distribution of data is in the normal distribution most of large data testing is normal distribution but what the meaning of it if this is what so called the score of my student if I divide it by the mean here if I divide it by the mean here you may see half of this will pass the mean okay if whatsoever I use 713 to cut this as a F half of you gonna be F won't pass it half of you gonna pass it right again there is the second factor called the sample standard deviation deviation in Thai mean biang ben is deviate okay when the structure has high standard deviation the curve will have the shape something like this the curve will have some shape like this the delta will distribute a lot more than the one that has low standard deviation okay if I set the standard deviation as the SD and I said this sample mean is the X bar sometimes we check the data by calculate the coefficient of variation to check how the distribution of your data. What we like to have the one that follow the black curve. We don't like the one that follow the yellow curve because the black curve provides us with the data in group. Okay, stay together, what I mean. And then by doing this, they're going to set the SD divided by the X bar and time 100 and set. For a good lab, if you test the steel, okay, the coefficient of variation supposed to be 7%. If you hire the lab to test the steel to you and you found that the coefficient of variation is 10%, that lab is a doubt. Okay, you may doubt the procedure of testing over there because 7% is the standard. That we use. And then next, if you produce a steel, you have your own company, okay, and you sell your steel with the strength of 713, you buy me 713, what happened is, according to the previous lecture, you're going to do the quality control test, acceptance test, right? And if you test it by this value, half will not pass. That means your company gonna get a lot of claim from your buyer. Is that going to be good to your company? A lot of people come here, your steel won't pass what you claim. That is going to be good. No, you're going to loss of money. How engineers prevent that? By the statistic. They're doing something like this. Some people just lower this by setting up the selling value of X bar minus SD. That means it's going to be 713 minus 16.2. And then your product will pass more. Okay, if you sell it over here. And if you check, if you sell it by putting it over here, by the X bar minus SD, you sell it with the lower stake, but your structure have your product will be a good quality one. A lot of them gonna be passed. Okay, if you first reduce it into another one, for example, if you reduce it into this, maybe this is 2XD, X bar minus 3SD, most of what you sell pass the specification. Okay, that's going to be very good, right? So when you sell thing, you develop a product. For example, if you go work with Ajahn Thirawat and then you do the research, you find that your lightweight brick wall going to have the strength, mean strength of 10 megapascal. You should not sell it at 10. You supposed to sell it at 10 minus 3 standard deviation. That's been most of your lightweight concrete wall will pass what you sell for. Okay? Don't sell it at the mean. If you sell thing at the mean, half will pass, half will not pass. Your product going to be a bad quality product. Okay? You may sell it by the mean minus 2, minus 3 SD or minus 4 SD to make your product pass all the way. Okay? But in reality, should we sell it at X bar minus 10 SD? That's maybe too much, right? So what is going to be? Maybe 1, maybe 2, maybe 3, maybe 4, or maybe 5 up into us. So that is the important that we going to find the mean, we going to find the standard deviation. Okay? I tell you about how important it is. Then why is the testing result always different? There are a lot of reasons. The error come from the test is the random error. It's maybe the random error due to the imperfection of the specimen itself. Okay, you have thousands of them. They are not the same. They are different. Maybe very small, different. Maybe large, different. The second one, we talk about the imperfect of the installation of the specimen. Some of you guys last week told me, Ajahn, your demonstration is not perfect. He said, you install the plate, it's not in vertical. Yes, sometimes when we hurry. Okay. And it may come from the measuring device. It's not calibrated correctly. Or last one, it may come from the electronic noise, those kind of thing. See, there is no people error. There is no people error. Don't write the lab report and say, that error is come from me. Don't say that. Okay. It just come from the device and method of testing, not come from you. Okay, there is a lot of devices. If you said you all know the word, yeah. This is micrometer, this is dial gauge, this is the load cell. Okay, there is different of them. All of them may be error if you won't calibrate it. And then for the tension test, actually, you can do the test like this. And what we have is, this is the result of, I think Dr. Jaksada, he is the lecturer at Rajamongkol Isan University. He now associate professor. He is applying for associate professor, really close to. And what I like to show you is this the specimen we call is coupon steel coupon five of them come from the same plate okay cut by the same people with the same cutting machine see they don't be the same okay so random error is just natural it's just natural we just know we must know how to manage it and most of the time in the laboratory report we just said this one has the yielding this is the sigma sub y bar we just do the average okay and also the same thing if you project this one and this one gonna be ultimate stress this is going to be sigma sub u bar there are error that's occur into the steel how about the concrete there is three group of concrete this is the first group this is the second group this is the third group this first group has the ultimate stress of 180 kilogram per square centimeter okay and this is 250 this is 320 and if you prefer to be in the mega pascal you can convert it okay what I'm saying is the same thing see they are not the same even though they mix together with the same cement same amount of water from the same mixing concrete mixing machine and just put it into the different concrete cast and cylinder just only that results are different so error are normal error are normal thing is most of the time we determine the sample mean and sample standard deviation to represent the data if the data is a lot like 50 data most of the test result going to be in the normal distribution again if it is in normal distribution come to my point okay it's called what so called is going to be reliability if you use this mean the reliability gonna be 50% ความน่าเชื่อถือคนไทยได้แปลง่ายๆคนไทยเข้าใจไหมความน่าเชื่อถือ reliability okay you can rely on it for 50% you can rely on it you can depend on it in another word for 50% if you move this one to an x bar minus sd now the area under the normal distribution gonna get larger that's mean reliability gonna be increased That's mean more increase and more increase. Okay, get the concept of this, right? It's just a statistic method. How to make things more reliable by using a small number of it. The very good example is going to be the mean you can calculate, right? Standard deviation also, right? You can do it by, and the SD, Sorry, the coefficient of variation I told you already. And the value of this is going to be by the standard. Like I said, if you get a lab that's produced the value of this for 10%, that lab is in question, okay? Or your specimen is in question. You can separate it. If you test it at AIT, And then you get this 10%, believe me, your product has some problem. If you hire an unknown testing company, there are more study about it. That's why people just go to university because most of the university are credited for those things. Okay, anyway, this is the table. And this is an example, just go through it. What example is here this is a cost of mechanics of material. Okay, I think this is quite a good example. You're going to grading the student an F. Many years ago, when this cost is still 430, that is at least 10 years ago. Okay, if you cut this by the mean of 40, the mean is 40, half of student will get an F. Okay, and if you cut this as 40 minus 1 SD, 84% of student gonna pass it. Okay, if Ajahn really so generous, cut it at 24, okay, 97.72% student gonna get an F. That mean from the previous term, we got 500 students, only a few of them get the F. Something like that. That is another way of using this. And we did a lot in our university talking about where should we get the F to the student. And we did say, oh, that's too much. You are so strong. Let's get a little bit softer, helping them, something like that. More generous. Don't be so cruel. Okay, that is two examples. That makes sense. One example. The first one, you are the manufacturer. You go to graduate school. You produce a special concrete to sell to the people. Okay. What you should sell, you should not use the mean. You supposed to use the mean minus SD or 2SD or 3SD, whatsoever you like. Okay, that is another way. The different way is here. That's for Ajahn. If you graduate, again, you are the lecturer at a university. Now, you're going to give the student F. What should you give them? You got to have the reason to do so. Okay, anyway, this is the thing for normal distribution, reliability. What so-called reliability is based on the normal, the bell curve, the normal distribution. By using the mean, the basic mean, that is 0.5 reliability. By using the mean minus 1 SD, this is minus 1 SD. It's going to be 84.1% actually, or 0.841, because the area under the normal distribution is 1. And if you go lower, okay, go lower, more gonna pass this. This is going to be 99.865. If you use this, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Even you use minus 4, that's going to be very small, like I told you. Okay, if your product has high quality, they come together, the SD is going to be very small. Even though you use 4 SD, the strength that you're going to sell your product still pretty high. If your data is flat, SD is large, and you minus 4 SD, you the value of the product you're going to sell is going to be really low. So make the product high quality. Okay, and use the high SD to minus the mean. And what we have here, we need to convert it. If the mean, that is 1 out of 2, the mean. If your minus is 4, 1 SD, the passing rate is going to be 84.1. Okay, that is 1 out of 6. If you said, it's going to be mean minus 2 SD. That is going to be the pass of 97.72. 1 out of product, 1 pass. And if it is mean minus 3 SD, 1 out of 740, 1 pass. If you are very high quality people, mean minus 4 SD That is 1 out of 31,600 won't pass. Depend on you. So just keep the two example and read my question carefully. Okay, carefully. And decide what the meaning of it. The mean 1 out of 2. If you use the mean minus 4 standard deviation, that mean 1 out of 31,600. Okay. And also at the end of this, we have some kind of example. There is 121 specimen. And after the test, you get this mean of this, 794. And then the SD is 38.6. You like to have the reliability of 99%. Go back to the table. Reliability of 99% is here. Okay. 1 out of 100 won't pass it. That's related to the mean minus 2.33 SD. Okay. And then that is going to be mean minus 2.33 SD. Just put the number into the equation. You got the value to have the 99% confident of 704, not at the mean, see? Okay. And then there is another thing that's called confidence level. What I'm talking over there, the table I just said, that is 100% confidence. 100% confidence come from large number of specimen. But in reality, we don't have that much sample. We have limited sample. That mean we got to put the confidence level into this. Okay, and then we have the equation. Something like this. We still use the mean, we still use the SD, but we're going to find this. This is going to be a factor for reliability of 99 with the 95% confidence. And then there are the table to compute it. This one is not in examination. The examination finished already from the previous example. This one just comes from some statistics that I took from the US Department of Defense handbook. Military thing. Military always not reliability. I must confidence with you also. Okay, they ask for the confidence. And then the confidence will depend on the number. If the number has getting larger, okay, the reliability with some specific confidence gonna get smaller, all of them get smaller. From this table, come from this equation. Don't worry, just your extra thing. If you work with SCG, like P. Thiraphon, he's now cooperation with the Siam Cement Group. When they're talking about this kind of statistic to develop the remix concrete. And then some people may just know about theoretical thing. You may be at that your value. I got some special thing from the US military department about confidence. Okay, just to add on to let you know. But we actually, even though during the PhD thesis, we didn't do much about confidence. Okay. And that is the end of chapter 2. Not finished yet. I need to brief for the lab 3. People, maybe Kanjanath, gonna be taking care of you for the lab. Anyway, by the meantime, I like to present you at least some guideline. In order you, the screen sharing has stopped as share window is closed. Okay. I have another one of, yeah, okay, over here. Okay, I'm going to go past this for your information. First one, I start by the TAS and I said the steel should be tested in tension. Why? Again. Because steel always use in tension. And the second one, steel in tension and compression behave similarly. We have very close to each other. So tension is easier to test steel. They select to test in tension. And now we're going to talking about the mechanical behavior. And if you recall from the third chapter, we have two things. We have the behavior of elastic. Put the force, elongates, release the force, coming back. And another one, we have the behavior of plastic. Some book said it is inelastic, okay? And then if you go further, the behavior in elastic separate into for the structural steel, yielding, called strain, hardening, okay? And then necking. On the necking, you come to the first lap. You have a chance to touch the specimen during the necking. I asked you guy, I didn't see any guy like to touch it. You didn't have much chance to touch that kind of thing, okay? In even though you graduate and you work as an engineer, so something in the lab, trying to take a look is closely, okay? Just be some special thing to your life. And what we have is then is talking about the mechanical property. When it's talking about the mechanical property, we are going to talking about the TAS. You know how to calculate it, right? And sigma sub u is yielding stress, modulus of elasticity, ultimate stress, percent elongation. That will based on the Thai industrial standard. But you still have something else to take a look for. Oops, that is going to be sigma sub proportion. That's going to be, what else? What else? Modulus of resilience. U sub R, right? There is a lot of things, but that not much important. Sigma sub F also, the important thing for the TAS, four of them. That is the mechanical property. And then you have the steel. Steel is what's so called the ductile material. That is going to be different from the cast iron, which going to be brittle material. Okay, and then we will talking about this later. Finally, I just let you know about the load controlling test. Remember when we be in the lab, we have the testing machine is be somewhere here and it have the load dial here, and then over here there is the wheel. This is the load dial, and then you also have this one is called the dial gauge, right? The gauge may be like this. Some people write like this. Some people write like this. This is American style, okay? Most of the people in the world write like this. I also confused when I study in the US, which one going to be correct? I study this in Thailand, but the people over there write like this. Anyway, when we talking about the load controlling test load controlling test when you do it oh sorry load controlling test when you do it you just take this one as the leader 0.5 kilonewton lead the rocket 1 kilonewton lead the rocket 1.5 lead the rocket 2 lead the rocket this mean load controlling test load is the leader okay however when you do something like this and you plot the graph let's see if you have the graph for the steel and then the graph is something like this okay and if you do the load controlling test the load gonna be the leader that mean the stress is the leader okay ask the load measure the elongation compute the strain ask the load okay compute the strain the load lead the read the elongation compute the strain if you go by this every portion must be equal this one gonna jump into this and then the curve you going to get is going to be something like this what happened is there is some error in this measurement due to the load controlling test so the load controlling test is only good for elastic behavior okay it is not good for the plastic behavior and then another testing is called displacement controlling test in the displacement controlling test the guy who control this okay before that during the load controlling test when you increase for 0.5 kilonewton the aggregate may rotate for 10 scale when you start to 1 is going to go to 20 1.5 30 okay 2 40 2.5 50 is going to go by 10 and it's going to go by 7 it's going to be close by 7 if it's go by 12 it's going to be grow closer by 12 for somehow at the yielding we don't need the load to increase but the elongation increase due to the change of the grain of the material what you do is what you will see this time the scale will move past 10 the load won't go yet to the point and past to 20 what the load would increase and past to 30 if you notice this point you got to change from the load controlling test to the displacement controlling test now this guy will be the leader okay this is 30 scale this guy lead the load 60 scale lead the load 120 lead the load okay that mean this one going to be leader and then lead this one coming into this lead this one coming to this lead this one coming into this lead this you can measure the yielding of the steel correctly most of the machine the expensive one use the displacement controlling test okay except very old testing machine still use the load controlling test so in conclusion the displacement controlling test can be test both from the elastic and the inelastic it also can test the steel it also can test the cast iron but for the load controlling test that's for the elastic behavior only the cast iron that has the what's so called the linear elastic to failure. The curve of the cast iron different from the steel is just going up like this and then fail. Okay, that means this one also appropriate for the cast iron. There are about 3 to 4 questions over here for the examination, believe it or not. This slide is going to provide you at least 5 questions. And don't worry, we will talking about this later. Not just this time, this just introduction. Okay, I will talking about this again and again. And then if you come to the tension test, you're going to determine the A sub O. You measure the diameter 1 time, 2 time, and 3 time by the vernier. Okay, you get the D sub O. And then you compute this by pi D sub O square divided by 4. And another question you have is the L sub O. There is 2 ways to measure for the L sub O. 2 ways. One, for this specimen, you push it into the UTM, and then you measure the total length of it. But for the deformed bar, this is deformed bar, okay? You got to have a hammer and the step. You must measure it for every 10 centimeter and put the stamp into it. Stamp. Most of the time, you got to stamp according to the length of it. Okay, and then you use it as the L sub O. Depend on the failure gonna be occur on this specimen. And then you put it into the UTM, the big UTM, different from this. Okay, the big UTM going to provide you with the, I don't know which one they are going to use, because they said the one in our F5 broken already. But I like to use that. People must check with P in the lab which one they're going to use, okay? But I think they're going to use the same DB12. And then for the small machine, you're going to have 2. One going to test by this machine, another one going to test by the bigger machine, okay? The bigger machine gonna test by using the deformed bar specimen. But this one going to test by this specimen. Again, like I told you, we are going to be what? We're going to measure this second and third file, this one. And then you're going to get the A sub O. And then you put this into the machine here. And then you measure the length before you apply the loading during over here. And it's going to be L sub O. And then you put the dial gauge into it, set into 0. For the cast iron, just use the load controlling test. For the steel, use the load controlling test until the yielding. And then you use the displacement controlling test. Okay, I should go very quick. Come to the diagram. From the small testing machine, you got to put everything in the table. Please have your own spreadsheet for the computation. That's going to help you. Last lab, you be in the lab for 8 p.m., right? 8 p.m. Some of the group finish the lab at 8 p.m. Because of what? Because the previous group work very slower than standard. Actually, we supposed to set the time for each group for 15 minutes. If they won't finish, just take him to the back of the row and let the author come. It's supposed to be like this. People, you got to take this thing into operation. If not, you're going to take really long time because students just keep working and working and do the mistake. Okay, prepare your table and you will plot the graph like this. By the graph, when you plot it, you will plot it by hand. You must buy the graph paper. Okay, they sell it in front of our Patu 1, Gate 1. And then what we got to find, you got to find the ultimate, you got to find the yielding, you got to find the modulus of elasticity because these mechanical properties specify in the TAS. And the author also. And you got to make some discussion about this graph. I think you guys are tired already. This graph, you can read it by yourself, right? If not, just go to my YouTube for the chapter 3 of mechanics of material. Okay, that is the old thing. And then the necking, we know about the necking already. And read the value from the graph. You also can read it from the graph, right? And finally, you got to find the percent elongation and percent reduction of area also in this YouTube from the previous lecture. And if you work for the cast iron, the cast iron has no yielding. You got to use the 0% offset to find the yielding point of the cast iron. Okay. And what I have is the behavior of cast iron. Cast iron can take very small tension because the cast iron has the carbon. Carbon has the micro crack. When you pull it, micro crack just open. When you compress it, micro crack close. And also due to the Poisson effect, the middle of the cast iron just get larger. So the cast iron can take very large load before its failure. And also, the failure of the steel is like this. In tension, the failure of the steel is necking, is due to the slipping of the steel grain. And that is caused by shear stress. Tension produce necking due to the shear stress, causing the failure of the steel in the form like this. However, for the cast iron, due to the micro crack, the force open the micro crack is cause the separation of the grain of the steel. That means it's failed by tension. And then the failure is in 90 degree with the direction of the force. And the author is okay. This is going to be the cast iron failure. This is going to be the steel failure. If there is something like this occur, that means there are some eccentric, a small eccentric during the test. And finally, there is the curve here. And I hope you guys can study it by yourself. And especially for this thing, you may have at least 2 examination problems. I can ask you about it. So, chapter 2, that's maybe have some computation, find the mean, find the deviation, find the coefficient of variation, those kind of things. Chapter 2 may have like a 10 problem. The Sensei test gonna be in chapter 4. This kind of lecture maybe provide you 5 problem. So today you may have 15 problem already. And with the previous one, you may have another 10. That is about 25. When we finish about lecture 5, we will have midterm examination. So the midterm examination gonna contain about 60 problems. we are nearly half of that. Okay. Okay. Sorry for the late lecture because I'm speaking too much. Actually, next time should be shorter than this. Okay. Enjoy your evening. Bye-bye.